Servus and welcome to my watercolor tutorial. Today I choose some winter mountain peaks as my template. I'm starting with the sky in a very soft and lightened way. With the same stroke, I built the silhouette of the mountain range below. A regular blue sky is a little bit too boring. I also cannot paint clearly clouds into the sky because they would be much too far away to show details. I would lose the depth of the painting. So I work a little bit with the kitchen paper, a few dark stains, a little bit water from the spray bottle, and the sky becomes troubled. And so you create the imagination from a cloudy sky in the distance. A few smooth dabs with the brush and the texture from the sky is good enough for me. Feel free to work with some dark and lightened spots on the sky. Let it flow with a little bit water. It should be your target to get a sky with a little bit character and not a boring one. On my template, the sun is coming from the right hand side and throws the shadows to the left hand side. I paint the shadows in levels where I get darker and darker with every level. In this technique, I keep the control about the darkness in the shadows and can decide if I want to go darker or not. It's very important to keep the white areas uncovered right from the beginning. There doesn't exist a white watercolor, but you can work out later some highlights with white acrylic color, for example. Some guys maybe don't want to do that because they say then it's not a watercolor painting anymore. But anyway, in this case it becomes a mixed media painting and anything is good. I don't want to paint exactly copy from my template this time. It only should help me to imagine how a snowy mountain range with woods and rocks and lights and shadows look like in real nature. Now I start the first details with dark color. I work on the first mountain peaks and I also start with the shadows. It's an advantage that the color of the sky isn't completely dry yet. So the peak shadows in the distance has the possibility to bleed a little bit into the color of the sky. The main colors I used until this point of my painting are blue and black. That means the blue of the sky contains a little bit of black and a small amount of red. And this rough sketch of mountain range and peaks also contains blue and a little bit black, and I adjust the proportion of the colors that way If the objects are far away, they melt more into the sky, then the blue amount is more than the black amount. And if the objects are closer, like these hills in the foreground or really black shadows, the amount of the black color is more than the amount of the blue color. Later I will add a little brown into this mixture of blue and black. Now I start to paint the next shadows, those very dark parts of the mountain peaks. Again, the color of the background is a little bit wet, and the shadow color has the possibility to bleed in it. On that way the shadows becomes a little bit softer, and that's important because those areas are in the distance and too many details in these parts would bring the whole objects into the foreground and the depth would get lost. Here you can discover the different layers from the light into the dark. With any layer the color becomes darker and darker, and that's the best way for me to control the darkness of the shadows. On that way you can really improve the contrast. And in this case you can create the illusion of different snow levels. If I paint a wood in the distance, like in this case, I simply dab the tops of the trees with the brush into the painting and cut it underneath with a wet brush, and in the same stroke I create the shadows. Don't paint single trees into the wood because the distance is so far you can't discover single trees and you would lose the distance. Only the top of the trees should be visible. Those trees also throws a shadow onto the left side. Only a shadow can make the sun shine. I didn't paint the sun itself, only the result of the sunshine. In this case my shadows are very long, therefore the sun stands low. I also shape the terrain with the shadow. If I paint the shadow in a bow down, it creates the illusion the wood is standing on a hill. especially in a watercolor painting, it's very important to create moods with light and shadows. Actually, not the shown subjects of the painting is what the people like, but the mood they feel while take a look at it. Now I start to paint more and more concrete details. They also get darker now. Shadows also become darker. Now you should try to don't overdo your shadow strokes. Not too much and not too dark. It helps me to get up sometimes, go a step back and try to sort the view onto my painting new. Here I glaze the shadows with the big brush and very wet color. And I try to create the illusion of big snowy areas on the shadow side of the peaks with blue, black and very wet brush. So white snow is hidden from the sun, blue snow is snow in the shadow. Now that will be the really last shadow level, the last one and the darkest one. And once again, please try to don't overdo it. It's very dangerous to getting too dark now and too much details in the background, and you will lose the distance. Please always remember objects in the distance, far away, don't have too much details. They don't have any contrast. They are soft and smooth, lighten because of the atmosphere and the air. And too much details in distance objects will bring all into the foreground, and believe me or not, you don't want that. Here and there a few details, a few single trees standing in a snowfield, and my watercolor painting with the snowy peaks is finished now. Thanks for watching. And Servus from Austria.